stimulants are the most used and considered the most effective medications for the treatment of ADHD, both in children, adolescents, as well as the treatment of adults with ADHD. Psychostimulants, this includes amphetamines and methylphenidate, are a broad class of sympathomimetic drugs. They increase not only movement, but arousal, vigilance, wakefulness, and attention. Some are considered drugs of abuse, such as cocaine. Others are socially acceptable, such as caffeine. But we're focused on the therapeutic drugs. And again, those are amphetamine, methylphenidate, and modafinil. These, at least the former two, amphetamines and methylphenidate, have received indications by the FDA through a number of randomized clinical trials. Now, we've been using stimulants for a long time, and even a long time in adults, and prescribing patterns have changed. For instance, amphetamine is now prescribed over methylphenidate, something that would be hard to note some 30 years ago when methylphenidate had a large lead over amphetamines. Adults now exceed children in the proportion of prescribed stimulants. Adult women more likely to receive stimulants than adult men. And not surprisingly, there has been a large increase in the number of stimulants prescribed for any group. Long-acting stimulants are seen for use more in children and adolescents than adults. Now, we've provided you with a number of charts of both FDA-approved stimulants, including some older agents, such as mixed amphetamine salts extended release. We look at methylphenidate products, such as Oros methylphenidate sustained release, Dex methylphenidate extended release, a number of different extended release methylphenidate preparations, including methylphenidate sustained release and methylphenidate extended release. As I implied before, one of the big differences between stimulant preparations is not only the amphetamine-methylphenidate dichotomy, but also formulations in terms of the time to onset and the duration of functioning or acting. That is, there are short-acting drugs that last from 3 to 5 hours, intermediate drugs, which last from 4 to 8 hours, and finally, a number of medications that last longer than 8 hours. And these are certainly preferable for those individuals who need medication throughout the day and may forget multiple administrations. There are a number of stimulant-related adverse events, some of which are fairly rare, such as psychosis or increased heart rate or blood pressure to pathologic levels. For a number of years, we've recognized that although rare, there is the possibility of serious cardiac events, including sudden death. These occur rather rarely, but it's important that the physician or prescriber screen for cardiovascular risk factors. These include symptoms such as chest pain, palpitations, and fainting. Review of cardiac history, particularly the history of myocardial infarction or structural damage, arrhythmias, congenital malformations. And finally, abnormalities in blood pressure and pulse preceding the prescribing of stimulant medications. However, others are more common, such as irritability, decreased appetite, plus or minus weight loss. The presence of the status of being a Schedule II by the DEA indicates a higher risk of misuse or addiction from stimulant medications. The discontinuation rate among adults due to adverse events is about 10%. As we mentioned previously, we like to consider longer acting over shorter acting stimulant medications. These result in better functioning during the course of a day and probably have lower abuse potential. In considering which preparation to prescribe, the clinician or prescriber should consider patient preference, should start low, but progressively increase the medication until there is no or little room for improvement, and balance side effects versus clinical effectiveness. During the course of treatment, the prescriber should monitor side effects through such things as vital signs, blood pressure, heart rate, or weight, should examine neurovegetative symptoms such as sleep or appetite, and ask about other somatic ills such as headache or GI distress. Monitoring treatment can be done through the use of rating scales. Some of the rating scales that I mentioned previously or some of the subscales can be administered at intervals to monitor the effectiveness of the drug. The presence of lack of effectiveness suggests a changing of preparation, or specifically a changing from amphetamine to methylphenidate or vice versa, prior to augmentation with non-stimulant medications. In terms of cardiovascular evaluation and monitoring, we mentioned before that it's important to, prior to treatment, to evaluate cardiovascular functioning through eliciting of symptoms, cardiovascular history, blood pressure, and heart rate. During the course of treatment, one should monitor blood pressure and heart rate, initially weekly, monthly, and then bi-monthly during maintenance treatment. The key points to this section are that stimulants, including methylphenidate and amphetamine, come in several formulations: short-acting, intermediate-acting, and long-acting. Common side effects include dry mouth, insomnia, irritability, decreased appetite, weight loss, and headaches. Less common side effects include exacerbation of tics, psychosis, priapism, misuse and addiction, and very rarely sudden death. Prescribers should screen for cardiovascular risk factors before beginning stimulants and monitor blood pressure and heart rate during treatment.